Hello, everybody. And now we are continuing our municipal GIS lectures. And nowadays, today's lecture is about geoanalysis and modeling. You probably know that in the picture that was adopted from Martin 1995, here is presented the GIS structure is presented. We have real world. However, this we have no full access to understanding what this world consists of, because we have everybody of us has its own point of view. Has its own background, and experience about how can we explain all the peculiarities of the real world. The next step is data capture. We have different sensors. We can capture the data about the real world ourselves using our eyes, ears, to create text and explain how real world works. However, also, we can use different techniques, different sensors, total stations, levels, GPS receivers, remote sensing platforms make different geo images of the territory, of the landscape, of the different real world features. The next very important stage is making geographic information model. Because our knowledge on real world is depend on our data model. We understand that we can use different data model. For example, you probably know that architects they use different sketches, different plans and drawings of the future building, and they often present their projects in 3D models. First of all, they use a computer aid drawing or computer aid modeling software, for example, Autodesk software like AutoCAD, Revit, AutoCAD Civil 3D, and other software. However, geographers use another kind of software, which is called geographic information systems. These geographic information systems has another kind of models in their core. in their middle. And the main purpose of this geographic information systems is data manipulation and making decisions using all this data from different data sources. So, and the last step of this procedure, of this algorithm, is data output, and we can present our data in different kinds, in different forms. For example, plot, map, sketch, 3D representation, and different huge amount of geo images. Speaking about our educational process, we have different the bunch of different processes while giving to students understanding of their future job. Our colleagues from Ukraine small group of scientists, they have developed Foundation for Future Institute, and they explain that we have a few processes: education, preparation, teaching, and formation. Maybe this is not proper translation into English from Ukrainian or from Russian. However, I just want to present you my understanding of what should we give to our students to make them best professionals in the field. Probably we should use all these four different forms of work. The almost all universities just give the students some information about research, about real world, and it means teaching. Teaching is giving information. However, in my opinion, we should also prepare the students for their future work and give them practical habits and practical skills. Not hard skills, but soft skills. It means understanding how they can work together, how they can make their work successful. Another directions is formation. It's not so easy to explain, but I will try. Formation means, in my opinion, to create a citizen, create a person, individual who can ask proper questions, search for answer on these questions himself or herself. And education in Russian means образование. It's very similar to formation. It's also creating of a new professional. Maybe students should educate themselves. Well, let's move on. Everybody should agree with numerous intellectuals, in particular Yuri Chudnovsky, who argues that study of the city is basically about the people who live in the city and the idea around which these people unite. The architecture of global world is based on the following ideas. Pragmatism, reduced to the concept of benefit, humanism, which concentrated in the assertion that man is a supreme being, and cognition, which has rejected God. This trinity dominates public discourse and is the backbone of the modern economy. The ideas of good, the common good, the universal good, probably this idea we can see in the works of Aristotle, for example, and all these ideas are relegated to the margins and left to philosophers and religious figures. Desecularization, which began in Europe in modern times, reached a special development in 20th century and continues now and since the church of the state is also on the margin. The modern state is separate from the church and the idea of the good. It establishes social orders in which the idea of the pragmatism, profit, dominates monopolistically. A score of not profitable is a death sentence for any idea. Well, in this picture, I would like to share with you an idea of classical education. You probably know that here you the seven free arts: geometria, mathematica, music, rhetorica, grammatica, astronomy, and the philosophy inside this flower. This is approach in which students in medieval time in medieval European university has got their habits has had got their worldview, understanding how our world works. Well, one of these three arts is geometry, and the geometry and astronomy is very close to cartography and to presentation of our Earth model. Speaking about maps, we should mention a few map functions. First of all, communicative or basic function, which consists in storing and transmitting spatial information. Well, a cartographer or GIS professional communicate with users through a map. It's just a kind of communication line between map makers and map users. Another function is related to the solution of various practical problems: orientation, road search, planning of economic activities, sustainable development, urban resilience, and so on. And the third function is cognitive function. It's based on the study of natural and social phenomena and the acquisition of new knowledge about them. In this case, the map acts in the dual role as a tool of research and as a subject of research in the form of a model. In this lecture, I will concentrate. I will concentrate on the cognitive function of the map. And speaking about cognition, we should give a small step aside and speak about René Descartes or Cartesi, René Cartesi. It is his Latin name. And the great scientific and practical significance of geographical maps allows them to be used as an effective means of studying the world around us, cognition function. Cognita ergo sum, usually this phrase of Cartesius, is translated as I think, therefore I am. Well, let's move to the method of studying the world is cartographic method of research. This method was very popular before computer revolution, before GIS creation, And this is an independent section of cartography which studies the features and directions of application of cartographic works, maps, atlases, globes, etc. We can use these models in various fields of practical, scientific, cultural, educational activities, develop a methodology for working with cartographic works, evaluate the reliability and effectiveness of the results obtained. I am, therefore. It's obvious, but how long have I existed? As much as I can think. It is quite possible that if I cease to have any thought, I will immediately completely disappear into oblivion. Therefore, I only assume what is necessary true, namely, I am only a thinking thing. In other words, I am a mind, a spirit, an intellect, a mind. This phrase of René Descartes explains how our modern world try to understand all the natural phenomena. René Descartes put reason in the first place, reducing the role of experience to a simple practical test of the data of intelligence. Rationalism in the thought of reason. Rationalism, according to the definition of philosophy, is a set of philosophical trends that make the central point of analysis. On the subjective side, reasoning, thinking, etc. From the objective point of view, reasonableness, logical order of things. Well, the question is, what is the purpose of using maps? The first purpose is getting knowledge on surrounding reality. Now, first of all, obtaining qualitative and quantitative characteristics of phenomena and estimated indicators from maps. Study of the structure, relationships, dynamics of phenomena. Forecasting changes in their location and development. Here you can see a fragment of Soviet topographic map of Ashgabat city. And this map shows all the land features, the city, built up area, the channel, Karakum channel, the mountains, and the huge amount of springs, freshwater springs, that is connected with this mountain ridge at the south of Ashgabat city. So every map allows us to understand not only phenomena, but also their relations, interrelations among different phenomena, about relief and hydrography, about relief and city growth, about roads, and also development of territory. Another example is famous cartographer Mercator and his navigation map. And in this white places. It was explanation about how we should use this map, because you probably know the Mercator projection. It is cylindrical projection. However, the scale at the equator and the scale at another latitudes is quite different. So we should. It is easy to measure the angles and the ship course, for example. However, the distance is not so easy to measure the distance using this map. And Mercator explain how everybody should use the map properly. Another example, probably you know one of these people at the left. It is the movie character Jon Snow. And on the right side, it's a real Jon Snow, who have lived in Great Britain. He is British physician, one of the pioneers of the mass introduction of anesthesia and medical hygiene. He is considered one of the founders of modern epidemiology. In the 19th century, the city of London, during the years of John Snow's life, from the 1813 to 1858, in advanced countries such as England, it was believed that the cause of serious diseases was miasma. Allegedly organic matter decomposing in soil, landfills, and stagnant water emitted harmful particles. If you breathe in such fumes, you should consider yourself infected. In the 19th century, several waves of cholera swept through foggy Albion. The authorities blamed them on invisible miasma. Jon Snow was more concerned with the poor sanitary conditions in the cities. They grew rapidly by leaps and bounds of the Industrial Revolution, but this was no infrastructure designed for hundreds of thousands of people. Household waste and sewage were dumped into cesspools in basements, backyards and dead ends, or even directly into nearby reservoir. The river Ayr, on which Leeds stands, was described under Snow as swallowing excrement from 200 private toilets and piles of public sewers. At the same time, the river was a source of drinking water. In 1832, a young physician arrived in the village of Killinort, north of Newcastle, to stop the spread of cholera in a coal mine. There were no sources of miasma underground, so why did the disease plague the workers? Snow drew attention to the fact that the coal miners went down to the mine for the whole day, where they not only walked, but also ate with unwashed hands and relieved themselves. As soon as the unsanitary conditions were removed, the cholera receded. Snow discovered the inconsistency of the miasma theory. Scientific authorities did not recognize the upstart. Another 16 years passed, and London was once again in the grip of cholera. It seems that only our hero wondered why the infected has gastrointestinal symptoms. After all, if the problem is toxins from the air, then why don't the lungs suffer? In the capital, a doctor collected statistics trying to convince his contemporaries that the source of disaster was polluted water. A striking example was the street on the hand of which this was a rampant epidemic. On the other, a single case of disease. The culprits were residents who dumped garbage into a ditch next to houses and a water tank. Sewage freely penetrated into the well. However, the innovative doctor was again disappointed. His pamphlet on the ways of spreading cholera was received coldly by scientific community. No wonder it took 30 years before Robert Koch discovered Vibrio cholerae. In next case of loud self-pronouncement presented itself to Snow only in 1854 during another epidemic. In between cholera outbreaks, he studied London water system. The Thames, like rivers in other megacities of the 19th century, supplied clean, in brackets, water and was polluted by household waste. Lambeth Waterworks and Southwark and Vauxhall were responsible for supplying the city with a population of 3 million. They did not use filtration, and Lambeth pumped water almost from under the sewer. The obvious result: in 1849, there were more cholera patients in the homes served by Lambeth. Before the new epidemic, Lambeth corrected itself. Its water was not was now cleaner than the Southwark and Vauxhall. According to Snow, Southwark and Vauxhall water accounted for 14 times as many deaths. The story of the famous column on Broad Street, now Broadwork Street, in the poor quarter of Soho, took place in the late August, early September 1854. Snow compared the mortality rate to the plague. To find the case, the cause, Snow mapped the location of the pumps and schematically the number of deaths. One piece of the map looked suspicious: the corner of the Broad Street and Cambridge Street. The number of deaths is 83, and 73 people, according to eyewitnesses, took water from one tank. The officials finally agreed with the doctor's arguments and removed the pen from the speaker. The epidemic died out instantly, but it was too early to put an end to the story. Later, It turned out that the water in the well came from a clean part of the Thames. The investigation was conducted by Henry Whitehead. A matter from the sediment on Board Street was a cesspool. Sewage from it seeped into the tank. The amendment is deadly savage. A sick child turned out to be patient zero. The liquid used after washing diapers went to the pit. The source of the epidemic is Luke tools, as Snow insisted. In addition, this situation showed the failure of the water supply system. In the picture, you can see the Gilbert's version of John Snow 1852 map of the Soho cholera outbreak, showing groups of cholera cases during the 1854 London epidemic. The black points is just ill people. And the distribution, spatial distribution of the disease helps to find the pump that supply bad water. Another example is Alexander von Humboldt studying the relationship between vegetation and climate. Substantiated the idea of horizontal vegetation zones in the plains and the vertical altitudinal zones in the mountains. In Russia, Humboldt's idea were highly appreciated and well on fertile ground. It was made by Vayekov, and his and Dokuchaev, who found and explain natural geographical zones were filled with new content, became complex. They included many components and properties of environment. Due to the presence of two large plains, Russia turned out to be an excellent testing ground for identifying horizontal latitudinal zones in a more or less pure form, quite close to theoretical models. At the same time, acquaintance of the Caucasus is relatively accessible to European researchers. By the middle of the 20th century, Soviet geographers had built a grandiose pyramid of physical and geographical zoning within the framework of natural landscape zones, similar to the linear taxonomy of plants and animals, and to the Soviet administrative territorial division, which in its complexity has no equal in the world. In the physiographical zoning of the USSR, zonal and azonal regions were combined and intersected. Standard taxa have become units of distribution such as natural countries, regions, provinces, counties, etc. Hundreds of thousands of natural areas runs were clearly depicted on maps, which became master. Алло. Ну, мене лекція. Well, in the picture by Alexander Gumbold, you can see isotherms or the chloroplasts of the equal temperature, isolines of equal temperature that moves to the north and the Europe, and it moves to the south in Asia, in Siberia. More precise understanding of natural zones have made by Vasilievich Dokuchaev, and this map has been presented on international exhibition in one thousand and 900s. It has been made in 1899, and you can see the French title. You can see the brown color. It's so-called black soils, and very similar soils in the prairie in the Northern America. And you can see almost circular distribution of these zones from the north to south. It depends, of course, on distribution of temperature and humidity and different geographical processes in the soils help us to understand this distribution. Another example, Lev Semenovich Berg was born in Bessarabian, in Benderi, in Bessarabian province, in the family of a notary. Already while studying at the gymnasium in Chisinau, Lev Semenovich became interested in independent study of nature. And then he entered Moscow University, where, in addition to studying, he performed a series of experiments on fish breeding. In his work, the experience of dividing Siberia and Turkestan into landscape and morphological regions, the geomorphological zoning of large part of the country based on morphometric analysis was given for the first time. And Lev Semenovich Berg described 14 landscape zones, of which the following are crossed into the territory of Kazakhstan: forest, steep Chernozem, semi-desert, desert, etc. Thus, Berg made a huge contribution to the study of natural conditions of Kazakhstan with his field research and theoretical works of generalization nature. Here you can see physical and geographical regions of Kazakhstan, and you can see this geographical zoning from the north to the south. Well, Lev Semenovich Berg also published a monograph about physical geography of Ukraine, and I have one. I have this book. Yeah, I have found it on Petrovka Marketplace, where the old books, where you can buy old books. Another example Johann von Humboldt. He was Humboldt's contemporary and compatriot. He published his isolated state book, in which zones of different specialization of agriculture, strictly calculated by prices, were located around a single city. Nowadays, models similar to Tunin's have gone beyond the boundaries of economic sciences and express layers of spheres of influence of various agents on the surrounding area, both clearly concentric and unrecognizably deformed by the transport network. Areas of influence of cities, transport hubs, enterprises, institutions, individuals, their ideas and opinions, event and news can be identified and mapped as zones. Zones can be called a series of elongated areas in the form of strips, which are naturally arranged similarly to the light spectrum and are associated with any quantity indicator that varies depending on the distance to the basis of zonality. A certain center level of center line. Such a view makes it possible to combine in one concept conditionally two-dimensional territorial zones and three-dimensional layers, for example, lithospheres and atmospheres. Zonality is perceived as a spatial form of the law of transition of quantity and quality. There is a model in which all the material diversity of the world is derived from the three actions: concentration, stratification, and intersections of zones. Here you can see von Tunin's model. The blue point in the center is a urban center and market place. Not far from the center, the specialization of territory is dairy farming, because the price, it makes not much time to bring dairy in the city. And then another circle is forest. The next circle is grains and field crops, and the last one ranching and livestock. Von Tunin wrote, imagine a very large city in the center of the fertile plain of any navigable river or channel. A plain can everywhere consist of the same soil that can be cultivated everywhere. At the great distance from the city, the plain can end in a desert, which completely cultivates the country from the rest of the world. Completely, maybe. Separates. Tunin came to the following conclusions. Perishable products, as well as products of goods with a high cost of transportation, should be produced directly near the city. As the distance from the city increases, the land will be used to grow products that have a low cost of transportation, with the same production cost and the same yield by weight. The product that depletes the soil more should be produced farther from the city, The product which requires more production costs, the more expensive it is. Per unit of weight must be produced farther from the city. The higher the yield of the production by weight, the closer it should be produced to the city. Around the city, delineated concentric circles are formed in which one or another product will be the main one. Here you can find the model Kunin's model modified by River. And the same spatial distribution, city, horticulture and dairying, forestry, crop rotation, enclosed field, three field, and grazing at the edge. Kunin considered the interaction of three factors of production location, distance to the market, prices for agricultural products, and land rent. The profit made by the farmer consists of the market price minus transportation costs, which increase in proportion to the distance to the market. On this basis of model, Johann Kunin made the following conclusions, which are still relevant today. During the movement from the center to the isolated state, of the isolated state to the periphery, there is a natural change in the systems of land use and specialization of agriculture. As you move away from the market center, the intensity of farming systems and consequently the cost per unit of production decreases. Transportation costs of transporting products increase with distance from the sales center. As a result, the market value of grain is approximately equal in all land use systems. The efficiency of agricultural production prevails in all zones or rings, he say. The main conclusion made by Kunin is that there are no absolutely profitable systems of land use, and their optimal choice depends on a combination of natural and socio-economic conditions. Here some texts that I have not translate.
That's not an issue. We don't have any English speaking students out there, so.
Sorry. Let's make the break now and continue in for 5 or 10 minutes.
Okay.